Did you know from the off that you were ready for this?
I figured if I could just get them to believe me physically as a character, that it would be mine. I really felt like James and I gelled in a nice way and seemed to have the, like, almost immediately I felt like I was right, like, my spirit was right for this character, and the way I sounded was the way he'd sound. I just didn't look the part, and I wasn't walking around in, like, the right vehicle yet. And so I knew if I could convince them that they could take a chance on me and give it enough time, I'd be able to make a create the, you know, change that was required to look like the character. I knew I would get the part, and so, and I also had an inside in because my friend Ben, who was essentially reading the role of Drax for all of the other screen tests, is like one of my very best friends.
And he's also one of my best friends.
Yeah, and we were really, and he was like, he's like, dude, you can't, Pratt, you can't tell anyone, but it's totally yours. Like, no one has come in and did what you did. You're going to get it. I was like, oh, that's good. You know, when the movie really takes off is when we zoom in on the Xandar Mall and we meet Rocket and Groot together, and you see Groot drinking out of the fountain, and you see Rocket with, you know, looking through his vid screen for potential bounties, and that to me is the moment that, like, there's this synergy that happens. Like, you take all of the parts, the Peter Quill, you've met Gamora, I don't think at that point we've met Drax yet, but you see, like, somehow the sum is greater than the whole, and it's when Rocket is talking and he sees, like, the little kid, and he's like, who's this little guy? Like, look at this little, you know, it's not cool to need help, or, you know, and it's like, it becomes really fun, and you see that this world, this journey is going to be really good. So I'd say Rocket. I think Rocket probably in that moment steals the show for me. I wouldn't mind seeing Peter Quill try to seduce somebody to, like, Lionel Richie. Yeah, like, put it on like he's a Mac.
Like
hello. Is it me you're looking for? And they're just like super serious and play a real, like, that's how he's been getting with all these Pumelians, is just like this one Lionel
Some
Richie
track.
Some
purple girl.
Some purple girl, and she's just like crying because it's so beautiful. It's the most beautiful thing she's ever heard. Just super easy to hook up with Pumelians if all you need is Lionel Richie.
See, this is what we do, guys.
Pumelians, it is really a fact that Pumelians love Lionel Richie.
Yeah, everyone knows that, yeah. Look, none of my ideas will ever make the movie, so I should just tell you all of them, because it will never be a spoiler. But I know that, like, in the comic, like, Gamora and Iron Man, you know, they have, the comics, they've hooked up. And how does Peter Quill feel about that? Maybe he doesn't like it, and then maybe Rocket hears it, that I don't like it, and then Rocket shoots Tony Stark, minute five, just blows a hole in his face? That would be amazing! People would be super mad, but it would be kind of great. You'd be like, what? How did you do that? And they're like, because Robert Downey Jr. makes $100 million a movie. We can't afford to have him anymore.
Pratt's minimum wage. Let's keep him around.
Yeah, we can afford Pratt. He kills everyone.
I would pay good money to read the fan fiction you write.
Yeah, right?
I think that answers your question. What song will be playing when you kill Iron Man? I mean, probably not Lionel Richie.
Hello. Is it me you're looking for? Credits roll. 7 minutes into the movie, it's over? Only worth it.
And then the rest of the movie is like a Weekend at Bernie's type thing with Robert Downey Jr.'s body to make him the most out of his contract.
It's skittering across the desert with the Iron Man thrusters on.
Yeah. He's flopping around his dead body in the Iron Man costume.
Yeah, totally.
Somebody get up and ask a question. We're gonna keep going all the way through lunch.
She's talking about this, like, really profound season of the OC where my character my character Che Winchester had a spirit animal, which was an otter, and it's really deep. It's like really kind of a subversive. I mean, actually, if you have like 45 minutes, I could kind of walk you through the episode. But that's a really good question. What's your spirit animal? What's your character's spirit animal? Would be the question. I don't know. Do you guys have an answer?
I'd like to point out I asked for a serious question. But
You know, I guess for me, my spirit, Peter Quill's spirit animal would probably be like a golden retriever. Yeah.
I see that. Yeah. I see that.
Okay. Yeah.
Chris, those are some impressively smooth dance moves you do. Devastating dance moves. did you come up with the choreography yourself?
Yes, I did. That was sort of a, you know, kind of a throwback. I think like everything about Peter Quill, it had to be 1988 or earlier. And so I thought of a lot of Michael Jackson, some moves from the disco era, a little bit of early hip hop and stuff like that. So I remember around that time in my life, my brother and I would have dance-offs in our basement. And so there was sort of that spirit in it a little bit. But yeah, those are my moves, and oddly never got paid as a choreographer, at least not yet, so.